Hi, thank you so much, and thank you everyone for joining us today to talk about graph visualization. This is a topic that has been dear to my heart for as long as graphs have been dear to my heart, which has been going on about a dozen years now. And there's always been something very beautiful about graphs because they have this very aesthetic quality to them as well, that like when you think about the graph model, immediately start to think also about how you can draw graphs and what they can look like. And in the last year, as a product designer here at Near4j, I have been engaging with customers and users and fans and other people in the community who are interested in graph visualization. And my point of inquiry has mostly been around trying to understand what do people really mean when they talk about graph visualization and what are they using graph visualization for? It can be both beautiful and useful and meaningful. And so what I want to share with you today is some of what I've learned over the last year. And I'd like to invite you to, of course, get in contact with me if you have some of your own thoughts around graph visualization and what you'd like to see and what you think about what I'm talking about today. So I'd like to start with to me, the most important aspect of anything about graph visualization is how is it actually useful? Why do people even think about graph visualization? It naturally comes to mind, but is there a purpose that it can be put to? And some of the answers that I've come to through asking this question have been these answers. First, people seem to think about graphs as just a thinking tool. Like our brains naturally tend to think in patterns and making connections between things. And so having a tool that lets you draw stuff and then make connections between things, whether it's Visio or some other just drawing package, or if it actually has data, if it actually has a connection to a database, then being able to visualize that data helps you think about what's actually there. So graph visualization becomes incredibly useful just as a way to think about a particular domain. Beyond that, if you happen to be a developer and you do have a graph database like Neo4j, or you just simply have data that you know is connected, it helps to think about how the connections are arranged in your data. So understanding all the structures in the data, and both on the modeling side, but also on the instances of data themselves, helps you develop any kind of application that you're building. So being able to work directly with your data model in a way that represents all of its connections is incredibly powerful. If you happen to be more of just a business user, some other way that you might think about graph visualization is that graphs themselves are a great way to communicate ideas. And so just being able to show different things and how they're related and patterns of how things are related can be incredibly useful for just describing situations and contexts that would otherwise be hard to just put into prose into some other visualization. So it's incredibly useful as just a communication tool. And if still, as a business user, you have your data in something like Neo4j, you may not know all of what's actually there. You might, want to actually be able to see your data and explore it to find out things that are there. And unlike other representations, like if you just look at your data as just in a table form, or if you even try to visualize tables, like and put them into pie charts and line charts and other kinds of charts, those are incredibly useful for looking at single dimensions of the data. But if you actually want to see, what the kind of the world you've created inside of the data, looking at it as a graph lets you see the individual things and how they're related and kind of walk through the world they've created as a graph. And even though it's mostly about just the connections, those connections themselves can tell you a lot about the business information that's encoded inside of the graph. So while charts, the sort of traditional charts like bar charts and pie charts and things, aren't themselves awesome for doing data exploration. Even if you have your data as a graph, you can then derive back to those single dimensional views so that you can have quick summaries of things as well. And a combination of the graph visualization plus charts can be useful for actually having a complete picture of what's going on inside of your business. And getting more intense along that same line of reasoning. The graph lets you do some pretty incredible analysis where you can really see, trends as different communities are developing inside of the data set. You can find anomalies in the data set where you expect certain patterns to always be true, and then every now and again they're not. There's either something missing or there's some extra bits that don't quite fit the rest of the structure of how the graph is formed. And that can be helpful for doing things like fraud detection, or even doing things like recommendations just visually. You can actually help you understand like how people how the data inside your graph is actually evolving, and then you can make, based on that analysis, you can actually predict what should be happening next. And in general, graph visualization is useful whenever you're interested in simply how things are connected in your data. And by the things in your data, I just mean whatever data you have, whatever domain you work in, whether it's already in the graph database or it's in some other data source, you can view it as a graph. And viewing it as a graph will reveal all kinds of useful information that's impossible to see otherwise. So after having done the survey, and I guess I should say I'm not really done. I'm continuing to do the survey. I keep asking people what they're doing with graphs. I've also realized that when people start to talk about what they want to use graphs for and what they love to see in a graph visualization, they also tend to have some assumptions about the size of graphs that they're interested in. Here, I've decided to describe the different sizes of graphs simply as you have really tiny graphs, graphs that you could easily describe on a sheet of paper, to small-scale graphs, to large ones, to giant graphs. And in each of those categories, you can find different kinds of examples that illustrate different aspects of the graph and like why you might use a graph visualization at different scales. So that's what I'll do next, is actually run through these different categories and show some examples of what I mean by, for instance, a tiny graph. So let's start there. Tiny graphs, what I mean is these are graphs that are basically, you could think like family size graphs. Like if you think about social networks, it's the people that you know directly, and maybe one level out past them, but it's generally like a small handful of nodes or items that are inside of a graph. The tiny graphs are perfect for just communication tools. They're a great way to describe a scenario with only a few concepts in place and with a very specific context. So it could be that you've abstracted out some ideas, or you could be just looking at a very small portion of a larger graph. But what's important is that you're really focused down on just a couple of things. So the nodes you're looking at are maybe in the double digits. Typically, actually, they're even maybe around a dozen to like 20. Seems to be a comfortable size for actually what you can describe very concisely inside of a tiny graph. And it's at a scale where each individual node that you've put inside of the visualization can have all the detailed information that you need to have that needs to be represented there. So each node speaks for itself. You can look at the node and understand what it is. So I'll give you an example of a super tiny graph. This is the smallest graph that I could think of. And so let me walk you through it here. So here we just have a pictogram, let's say. So we have this lovely woman, a heart symbol, and then this lovely gentleman. Now, you could assume that these people have names, of course. So let's say that this is Anne and the other person is Dan, and that the heart represents love. So this could actually be a representation of this, a very, very simple graph where it simply is expressing that Anne loves Dan. The simplest graph you can really have, I suppose, would be a single node, but graphs are all about relationships. So if you don't have any relationships, you don't quite yet have, if you don't have any connections, you don't quite yet have a graph. So two nodes and a single relationship between them becomes a perfect illustration of a super tiny graph. And this, you could see how this would compose into slightly larger expressions of graphs, but still what's important here is that you're keeping the context very small for the tiny graph. And this also illustrates, of course, the fundamental components that go together in a graph. I've been saying the word node a couple times now. Nodes are just the generally things that are presented as circles inside of a graph representation. And the connections between them, the arrows that go between the nodes, we call relationships. So you just have a node, a relationship, and then another node. And that's it. That's all you need to create a graph. Some other examples of on the small, tiny scale of kinds of graphs that you might produce. If you're a bit more sort of developer-oriented, you certainly might think about things like a state diagram, where you know that there's only a handful of possible states for a thing to be in, and so it's pretty handy to draw them as a graph and show how you can move from one state to the next and possibly loop back around. Here, this graph is interesting because it shows, it's also got some color coding to help you quickly understand the active states versus the inactive states, and what I would say is the sort of transition states, the two yellow ones there that are in between. Color coding itself ends up becoming one of the most important aspects of any graph visualization. whenever you're doing graph visualization, deciding how you want to use color and how colors use at different scales is one of the key things you'll actually make decisions around. Color in like a pie chart, let's say, is mostly an aesthetic choice, but in most graph visualizations, color performs a very important function for helping people actually understand what's inside of a graph. So even here in this tiny graph, the color is adding extra information about what's going on here. A slightly larger but still tiny graph, and familiar to anybody who's had to figure out workflows or processes, is you might end up writing a diagram like this. And these diagrams have been around forever, before people have had graph databases, before people have thought really about graph visualization. But this is a version of having a graph visualization, of course. And this here, again, you know, this happens to be a pretty small set of things that can be done. The workflow that's being described is not complicated, but it's enough that, you know, somebody can focus on exactly this one particular context, and you can communicate with them exactly what, you know, needs to happen, what their decision points are, and what the outcomes are. This, if you're into doing any kind of data modeling, it's also another graph visualization. Whether it's an ER diagram or some sort of UML diagram of a data model, this is common throughout computer science. Whenever you're building applications, people make diagrams, something like this. And this too is a simple graph visualization. It's a tiny graph that illustrates a very specific set of entities and how those things are related. And here there's also some color coding. The color coding really just separates out different, let's see what actually, yeah, so sort of user level things versus particular fields that can be represented in this data model. And this, and actually each of this, the tiny graphs that we've shown, an important idea as well is that the tiny graph happens to focus on a small number of nodes, but the basic idea, the concepts that are involved, can simply compose into a larger and larger scale. And at each scale, you have different focus of what kinds of activity you might do at that scale. So once you've gone past just doing like domain graphs or state diagrams or these other tiny graphs, all of these are in a general category of what I would call infographics. These are easily consumable ways of just representing things that are connected. So you see how they're connected and why they're connected, and that they all kind of belong together in one kind of a context. Here, this is, of course, showing a much more artistic rendering of exactly the same kinds of concepts that I've had in the previous couple of slides. If you bump up the size of your graph a little bit beyond the tiny graphs and you get into the small graph realm, here it's, you know, once you start getting into like about the high double digit into the hundreds of nodes, I would still call those small graphs. And by the time you've got a few hundred nodes within a single graph visualization, it's much harder to communicate very specific concepts in that. So that's why I classify this as a separate use than tiny graphs. With the tiny graph, you still have enough, you have a small enough number of ideas going on that somebody can actually understand exactly what you're talking about. By this scale, there's too many moving parts, as it were, for somebody to have a very precise understanding of what you would want to communicate. And instead, the use case here shifts from being communication to being all about navigation of the graph. In terms of social scale, this is, you know, around from the family size, but going up to closer to like something like a neighborhood that you might have around you wherever you live. So hundreds of nodes, possibly. And the node detail level drops at this point. Generally, as you increase the size of all graphs, the amount of detailed individual information you represent drops as well. So here, instead of having detailed information about the nodes, we expect to see graphs that have representative node information as well. So you won't see lots of information about each node. You'll just have some idea about, let's say, the node's identity. So things like that are more likely to appear. This is a very small graph. It doesn't have hundreds of nodes. This is a subsection of what would be, you know, potentially a large network diagram. This is the sort of diagram that people who do use Neo4j in like a telecom context have huge versions of this, where they actually do end up with, you know, hundreds of routers and hundreds of firewalls and hundreds of network devices and laptops and switches and everything else, plus power supplies and the rest, all in a single diagram. And generally, these kinds of diagrams are used for people just to get a quick overview of like the lay of the land, as it were. And often these things end up being interactive as well, where in addition to being able to navigate around, the visualization will end up highlighting different alert areas whenever there's a concern. So when the alarm bells start ringing, if you turn to the graph visualization, you'll actually see the parts of the network that are having some sort of a problem, and it lets an operator quickly zoom into that part of the area and find out exactly what's going on. So from the smaller graph, they generally tend to zoom into the tiny graph so that they didn't see the detail they need to know to figure out what the problem is and how to resolve it. A slightly larger but still small graph and common in most organizations is, of course, at some point you end up drawing an org chart. The org charts are typically start off as trees. Most people just like to think of who's reporting to who, so it's a reporting structure that ends up describing what the organization looks like. We all know that organizations are much messier than this, and this simple chart that looks like a tree probably has all kinds of links that go across each of the different departments and from individuals within the departments. And so just by adding additional relationships here, this simple tree view ends up becoming much richer. And when you've added those extra relationships, navigating your organization suddenly becomes possible that you could find from somebody, you could do the traditional thing, find out who they report to and who reports to them, or you can also find out what projects that they're on and who else is on the project and what other departments are associated with that. So you can find all kinds of interesting things about your organization once you put it into a graph beyond simply knowing what the reporting structure looks like. But this is always a good place to start. It's a very natural, comfortable place to start and very familiar. So this is pretty good. Getting slightly larger in the small graphs, but still at an easy comprehensible scale. This hasn't gotten out of hand yet, but route maps are a typical example where you have lots of stops, and you see, of course, the actual routes that connect those stops together. And as the maps tend to be, this is all about helping people understand what is possible to navigate. Or if you happen to be a train operator, perhaps you can take a look at this and you'll be able to see what lines are down. You'll know what else is being affected and how to reroute things. Here in the transport underground of London, there's not a lot of rerouting opportunities. If this map was extended a little bit to be also surface level maps and walking routes and everything else, then rerouting becomes a much more interesting task. This is still at the scale where it's sort of a human scale understandable, like that you could hand this kind of a map, this size of graph to somebody and they could make sense of it and actually work with it on a daily basis. So it's a very accessible scale of graph still at this level. Around the same size, and now shifting the focus a little bit, here this is just an example of a graph where it's composed of various people who are on boards of different companies. And for each board, the members of the board have been clustered together a little bit, so they're drawn in the same part of the graph. And if somebody happens to be a member of multiple boards, then they're actually replicated so that they'll have multiple nodes that represent them in this particular visualization. What's interesting here is it illustrates that at this scale, the more nodes you add, you start to shift your perspective from caring about the individual nodes to actually being a little bit more concerned about the clustering of nodes, like how nodes are related and the relationship of the things that are related. So you can start to pick out, even just scanning through this, you can easily count the number of boards that are here, because you can see all the bunches of nodes that have been put together. The color coding, of course, helps with that as well. And the color coding helps you see as well that some of these people are in multiple boards. You can kind of trace around a little bit. And typically with an interaction, what you would end up doing is going from this and then switching back down to the tiny graph if you want to drill into somebody in particular, if you cared about, let's say, James Cullen, who's somewhat in the center of this graph here, you want to find out more about him. This scale of graph is hard to see detail about him. You would want to zoom back into a tiny graph and then expect to see some detail about what's happening with James Cullen and his particular neighborhood and all of his involvements. Stepping past the small size graphs into what I would call the large scale graphs, These are graphs that are, in the tens of thousands of nodes, probably starting actually around 1,000 nodes and on up from that. But by the time you get into the upper hundreds of nodes in a graph visualization, the information density is so great that it's hard for it to be very useful for looking at individual things. So the previous example of that board graph visualization it really illustrated or pointed the direction towards what you start doing in the large graphs, which is that you start to look at aggregated information rather than individual information. So the detail level that's typically highlighted at a large graph scale is all about the clustering of information. So categorizing things based on how similar they are or some other criteria so that you're considering the groups of things rather than the individual things at this scale, at least visually. Some examples of this that are helpful. This tends to, at this scale, I think a lot of the people who end up working here are in the biosciences realm. This is an example of a protein network. Visually, just looking at this, it's pretty, perhaps you might say. It actually looks, it looks interesting, it looks meaningful, but it's very hard to tell just by looking at it exactly what's going on until you start getting some idea about the color coding. So the color coding ends up being very important here. I'm looking at the red and yellow drug targets, red for cancer and yellow for other diseases. And then the smaller dots are actually connecting the protein interactions with each of those. And what's interesting is you see the red and yellow drug targets are clustered around the different kinds of protein clusters here. So it's almost like a two-level of clustering here where the drug targets are a function of the proteins that actually interact with them. But again, so what you're actually getting in terms of the information in this graph is really about the clustering of what's possible. And then you could imagine interactions here where you actually want to drill down to a particular cluster to figure out what are the proteins that are represented there. And you could probably end up finding out which of those proteins are the most influential, who have the most interactions, successful or not with the drug targets. A little bit more success, accessible, perhaps just in the old classic social networking realm, is looking at Twitter communities. Here in this graph visualization, coloring has dropped entirely from being colors of individual nodes. Now the coloring is actually on the relationships rather than on the nodes, and the color coding maps to different communities within this particular user's Twitter network. So this is their Twitter network of anybody that they've directly interacted with or has followed them or that they follow or that they've exchanged in some sort of, they've referenced each other in a tweet. So all the people who have occurred in this individual's Twitter connections. And the individual nodes that are being here, they've just used this tiny pictograms. They're actually, some of them are big enough that you can kind of tell what they are, I guess, that's actually still useful at this scale. If this was to go out maybe to a second level out, so that the scale was closer to, let's say, around 10,000 nodes or so, then it'd be impossible to actually get much use out of the individual nodes themselves, and this color coding would be the only thing that really matters. Here the color coding is based on really, the hashtags that indicate different areas of interest that the user has done some analysis on to try to highlight who the communities are around them, and so they understand what kinds of different communities that they interact with. This is the first example where people are starting to do, or this visualization is starting to think more about analysis of what's going on in the graph rather than trying to communicate some specific information about what's going on in the graph. This is along that same theme with a bit more in terms of the node count. This is an example of the Harry Potter fan fiction universe. Each of the nodes here is an article of fan fiction. So somebody who's written something about Harry Potter that is not the Harry Potter author themselves, not J.K. Rowling's. And the color coding is both affecting the nodes and the relationships. And here it indicates what language the fan fiction was written in. It's interesting combining both the graph structure and the color coding, where you can see the communities, predominantly an English community that's done most of the fan fiction, a small Spanish community, and a slightly larger, but still smaller than the English-French community of fan fiction. You could easily put this you know, in a pie chart and show, like, you know, how big of a chunk of fan fiction is written by people in English versus Spanish and French, but that really doesn't capture as much of all the rest of what's going on in this community. This simultaneously shows the relative amount of activity in each of these communities for writing the fan fiction, and it shows the interactions between the communities, which cross over and reference each other all through this Harry Potter universe and writing stories that extend other stories or reference other stories, which combines both the network effect of all of this community and, you know, being able to see the relative size of the communities at the same time. So you're getting to see multiple dimensions of the graph at the same time. When I mentioned at the beginning of the webinar the idea of starting to do some amount of business analysis, this is exactly what I mean, that here it's still a graph, but it's a graph actually showing what you might otherwise do in a pie chart, so it's crossing over a little bit. The next size up in graphs, I just refer to as the giant graphs, and to be honest, I've yet to hear somebody give me a really good reason to visually display a giant graph. Here the scale we're talking about is, you know, hundreds of thousands to millions and beyond. I've seen graphs that are absolutely mammoth and impressive. Technical feats, you know, to actually get the graph to be rendered, and there's a bit of physics involved in actually figuring out how the layout should work, and that's very complicated, very compute intensive. So it's very impressive to see these graphs, but it's not really clear to me exactly how useful they are. In fact, I tend to think that they're maybe the least useful of the different graph sizes, except if you want to simply impress somebody with the scale of the domain and certainly the effort you've gone into to producing the size of this graph. And of course, I should note, here I'm talking about scale in terms of visual rendering, not in terms of like the data set itself. As is usually the case, like the most graph databases and most, you know, databases, I guess, can handle data sets far beyond, you know, the scale without too much trouble. This is what people have tried to do visually. Here is actually a rather small giant graph. This is, again, going back to Twitter. This is a sample of some network Twitter users. And again, this sample size here is just drawn from a couple of users, or I guess a user community that has interacted for a certain period of time. Here it's showing just all of the nodes without any of the relationships. Pretty evident already, I guess, even without putting the relationships in there, that this is neat to show that there's a lot of people. Like, you get a sense that there's, you know, a lot of individual users here, but it doesn't really mean a whole lot. This next diagram is of that exact same sample of users, but here showing just the relationships, but not the nodes, and it's the same thing. This perhaps is slightly, I don't know which one you prefer aesthetically. This is nice and fuzzy feeling. It feels like it might be like a dandelion seed or something that's, you know, it's about to puff off into the wind. It looks quite pleasant, but again, not clear exactly how much information you can derive from looking at this. If you combine the nodes and the relationships together and then allow a little bit of physics to be applied so that you get a force layout, it does look like there's some really interesting structures here. You get a sense of almost, this looks like suddenly like it could be a galaxy type structure with, you know, this very dense core in the middle, and then almost you can almost see rings of influence emanating out from that center. It's fascinating to look at, but not necessarily terribly meaningful to look at. Certainly not on I think, a day-to-day basis. This isn't the kind of graph that will help you make a lot of decisions in your life or in your business. But it's a pretty impressive feat. And speaking of, you know, looking at galaxies, this is another example of super large-scale graphs and graph visualizations that look really cool and look really interesting, but may not be very useful. This is from the Cosmic Web, and actually this is one of the graph visualizations that I've had the most fun just exploring. It's really interesting to explore. This is derived from looking at galaxies, all the known galaxies that we have, and deriving a graph from the gravitational influence that they have over each other. There's a threshold that was applied. And based on the threshold, like, you know, how influential particular galaxy is over another one, there's a relationship that's created. And it ends up just, you know, with that information and then applying physics, basically recreating the structure of the known universe, which is incredible and fascinating, and a lot of fun to explore. And actually, this because it probably recreates pretty closely what you would see in the night sky, if you're an astronomer, this probably is a useful reference point if you want to actually use this as a basis for exploring the world. And that a large scale graph exploration as a way to see an entire graph, and then if you can zoom into parts of it, probably is one of the most useful parts. If you have an interactive large scale graph that lets you zoom into parts and find things within it, that would be pretty useful. There's a similar scaling challenge and utility around visualizations of the brain, where if you look at the brain as, of course, a giant neural network, biological neural network, you can see that graph and you can map the position of the nodes. Rather than using a force layout, you can map it to the anatomical position of the different neural pathways. And then, as part of what's also happening here in this visualization, is that they're highlighting different active parts of the graph, which map to, of course, different physical structures within the brain that are active, that they're doing as part of their research here. This is from some neural network research. I actually know that there's some communities who are engaged in starting with the graph as their model for how to find stuff, because when there are researchers who are interested in doing any kind of work with the brain, there's, for instance, tons of literature about different parts of the brain, but it's not always obvious. You know, if you're looking at a part of the brain, there's not an easy way to just search for, okay, what's the relevant literature for this part of the brain? What are the studies? What are the outcomes? What do I know about this? And so if you imagine taking this anatomical representation of the brain and then just decorating it with all of the research that you can find, then it becomes a world that you can dive into to actually find information. And for researchers, because they know where they're starting, the brain isn't just interesting to look at as it is here, this actually does become useful. And again, a little bit more commonplace now. One of the biggest networks probably that we're all familiar with is that the internet itself, of course, is a giant network. It's a network of networks. This visualization is almost artistic in its rendering, I would say. Actually, it has somewhat of a painterly quality to it. And this is a visualization of just network routes across the internet back in 2005. I haven't been able to find an updated version of this, but this was a pretty great thing to look at. You can here get a great appreciation for the overall complexity of the network. And again, maybe so contradicting myself earlier, giant graphs probably are most useful as a way for getting an overall sense of this huge data set, and then zooming in to one of the smaller graph sizes, either the small or, you know, if not the tiny graph size, to actually see useful information about, like, what's actually going on. At this scale, it's interesting and pretty, but there's not a lot of information you can draw here other than maybe being able to identify places that you do want to zoom into to find out more detail. So what if you do want to show all of that scale of graph, if you want to show, you know, millions or billions of nodes at the same time, but actually have more information encoded there? There's a few techniques that people tend to apply. One of the first things that people do that's useful across, I would say, from the large scale and then maybe into the giant scale. It's probably not as useful on the giant scale, but at least at the large scale and the upper end of the small scale graphs, something called area grouping, where you define an area of the graph either based on some sort of categorization or some sort of clustering algorithm. And rather than have everything floating free, you take that area and say, okay, all of that gets to be self-organized into its own area, and you put every node into an area, and then those areas internally do their own layout, and then you just have layout amongst the areas as well. That helps reduce the mass complexity quite a bit, and makes it a little bit easier to see what's going on, while having a bit of a compromise here where you can still see the individual nodes, of course, at this, so you can't really do this with graphs that are too large. You can't do it too usefully, but it's nice for, you know, larger size graphs. A similar technique is then if you actually have done some grouping, either because you've done it manually, you've decided that's just some criteria that means that nodes actually should be considered as a group, or because you've applied some clustering algorithms, so based on their structural position within the graph, their location, so to say, within the graph, rather than showing the individual nodes, it's pretty common for people to actually collapse those nodes into a single node representation and then simply illustrate, you know, how many nodes qualify for that category or for that grouping. Here, what's been done is this is actually a clustering that's been done on top of the AdventureWorks dataset. Somebody had taken the AdventureWorks dataset, imported that into a graph structure, actually, and then within the graph structure, just started applying clustering algorithms based on similarity. So things that had similar kinds of properties and similar connectivity were considered to be part of a cluster. And then within the clusters, clusters with similar names were then also grouped. So it's applied actually two techniques at once here. You can look at the product inventory group, for instance, and you can see that there's a trio there that has, you know, altogether they are nodes that represent product inventory, but there's, you know, some subcategories there based on how they're actually connected to other things. Or actually, I guess, let's see, the orange ones have only, yeah, the ones with an orange ring are only connected to just the location, and there's other parts of the product inventory that are connected directly to the product, the product itself has actually also been split out. So if you would turn this, probably crank this clustering algorithm one step further, we might be able to get the products to collapse together, and then perhaps those two product inventories would collapse together, and we would only get two clusters rather than three in that subcluster. But so this, even as it is now, what's emerging is that by applying clustering in this way, you're actually getting a glimpse at what the data model of the graph is, which is an interesting aspect of all this, is that clustering is the same thing as if you're deriving a data model rather than as is traditional sort of imposing a data model on the graph. The other part of the visual complexity of graph visualization, of course, is the edges themselves. Here in this example, you know, there aren't that many nodes, but there's a ton of edges, and it's kind of hard to really see what's going on. So there's this idea of doing edge bundling, where if you have, and you can kind of visually pick out a little bit that there are areas where there's a lot of nodes that are headed in roughly the same direction from roughly the same area of the graph. So the edge bundling is a technique for actually taking those things and collapsing them down to single edges or trunks of edges rather than having them all at their individual routes. And if you apply that, that same network now becomes a lot easier to pick out, and you can see, you know, the density, you can see, you know, the heavy trunks. It looks like, you know, that's obviously, this is roughly a map of the U.S. that's ended up being graphed here, and you can see how it's, you know, basically the Chicago area with links to New York and to New England, and across to what must be Los Angeles, and up there in the north probably is Seattle. And just by collapsing all those edges, the picture of really what's going on becomes much more useful. The individual edges at this scale aren't helpful, so by simplifying the graph and collapsing them together, you actually get more information rather than losing information. So one thing to notice about that idea of bundling, which happens either by doing node clustering or by bundling the edges, by simplifying the graph, that's a way of just aggregating parts of the graph and making what was a large graph a little bit smaller. So I've noted as I've talked with people about how they apply these techniques and what kinds of graph visualization they do, that there's this kind of cycle of complexity. And here I've mapped it to the different sizes that I've been talking about, so that you can see like that as you increase the scale, so as you're adding more nodes to the graph, it's becoming more and more complex. So if you start at the tiny, if you start at those, you know, a dozen or so nodes, and you elaborate on that graph until you've got a small size graph and then a large size graph until you get to a giant graph, along the way, the complexity of the graph has increased dramatically. And typically, the information density has actually dropped along the way. if you want to restore some amount of information density, you head back down the scale towards the tiny size by applying certain aggregation techniques. So you can go from the giant by doing a little bit of clustering, get down to the large, maybe do a bit of edge bundling, maybe do a little bit more clustering, and you end up back down at a small, and you might be able to compress the graph all the way back down into a tiny graph. Actually, maybe if you could get a giant graph down to a tiny graph, probably you've lost some information along the way, to be fair. But this is a general pattern that seems to be true as I've watched people's different techniques and like what they actually do with real-world graph data and real-world graph visualizations. Okay, I've been, of course, talking through just the standard circle and line diagrams of graphs with generally a force-based layout for figuring out what the positioning is. Graphs are, of course, useful in other representations as well, so I want to do a quick run-through of those. And give you an idea of like what's possible. The radial tree is a very popular representation that's pretty useful when you have small size graphs. So looking at, you know, maybe in the tens to hundreds of nodes. And this is, in one way, of course, it is just a tree diagram. So it's similar to what we had done with the org chart earlier in the presentation. But here, the center node, what's interesting is that usually when these things are employed, that the radial tree can shift its focus so that here going from I guess it's flare that's in the middle right now, if you picked query, the query could become the center of the radial tree and you would see two or three levels out from a different node what's surrounding it. So this actually becomes a really interesting way, a more useful way to explore a tree than if it was in sort of a top-down hierarchical view. This is still representing the hierarchy, but it makes it feel more natural to actually navigate through the hierarchy. Recentering a hierarchical view on a sub-node would just feel awkward, and actually there'd be a lot more shifting around. When you've got it in a radial tree, you can still remain in quite the same context without a lot of things moving around and explore different aspects of it. So this is great for doing graph exploration for things that are generally focused on two or three levels out of connections from a central node. Of course, we saw that one Twitter map that was, you know, geolocated. Geolocation and doing geomaps is pretty popular because so much of the information that we have has some sort of geospatial information around it. So grounding things in that geospatial location and then just drawing the connections over that is always pretty useful. Little less obvious maybe, unless you've done a lot of work with different chart types, there's something called the core diagram. Core diagrams shift the focus from the nodes to the relationships between nodes, and specifically they tend to treat nodes as groups. So there's an implied bit of clustering that's going on here as well. And you're looking generally at like how these groups relate to other groups, and the thickness of the relationships ends up being something that's easier to see here. Like when you see it in a force-based layout, relationships are good for showing the connectivity. With a bit of bundling, you can get an idea of, you know, popular routes and unpopular routes, but it's not really relationship-centric. A core diagram ends up being really focused a lot more on the relationships between nodes. It's not really suitable for too many nodes, so this is really at the tiny scale or maybe the small scale, but I think really this is still tiny scale graphs. Shifting back to your attention to our nodes, something that's also helpful is to drop the relationships altogether, and on your way towards doing any kind of clustering is to, rather than immediately go right to the clusters and abstracting out the clusters, showing all of the detail, but also then the hierarchical clustering of things. So here in a circle packing diagram, this is as if you're seeing multiple clustering levels at the same time. So you could use this as a way to drill down into a graph data set. It's useful on its own to see the relative area size that's occupied by different content. But then also as an interactive, this is a pretty popular way to actually drill down into areas of interest because it's pretty easy to see the entire lay of the land, as it were. And then flipping back to talking about relationships, if you want to try to compare the relative thickness of relationships. The core diagram is useful for seeing the different thicknesses. It's hard to compare different sizes of relationships there. Something like a Sankey diagram lets you highlight that a lot more. So you can easily look at this and imagine that it's as if you're looking at a cross section of the graph, but obviously focused on the relationships, and the relationship thickness usually ties to some sort of numerical value. Here, this is a flow diagram. I think this is heat flow diagram that's being actually illustrated between different processes. This as well is useful for both for the immediate illustration of the different relationships, but you can have this be pretty nice as an interactive, so that you can drill down into something like, you know, you could look at by the industry here. If you clicked on industry, you could have the Sankey orient around that and see things coming into and going out of the industry box. And so you have like an interactive that lets you really highlight the different values of relationships in the graph. Okay, that was my whirlwind tour of graph visualization of the different kinds of graphs that I've seen, and some representative examples of them. And there's, of course, so much more than this. As far as I'm concerned, like, this is a discussion that I've been engaging over the last year, that I'm just now starting to take some notes around and formulate some theories around. So I'd love to hear your thoughts about what I've been talking about. Of course, my main theorem at the moment was a different class of utility in different sizes of graph. That's an idea that I want to explore a lot more and try to have a bit harder numbers around, and actually maybe do some perceptual testing around as well, so that we can have a bit more scientific understanding of how to use this chart type in the best way. The classic chart types have been well studied and well described in lots of different literature, and graph visualization has also lots of academic papers involved in describing graphs and how you can do graph layouts and how you can do mapping to different things. But the best practices for how you use graphs and when to use different sizes of graphs is unexplored territory. So it's territory that I'm looking forward to exploring a bit more. So I'd love to hear any of your input about it, and have a conversation if you'd like. So please don't hesitate to reach out to me.